the Holy Gospel according to St. John, the first chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
And the Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory as of a Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. John testified to him and cried out, "This was he of whom I said, 'He who comes after me ranks ahead of me, because he was before me.' From his fullness, We have all received grace upon grace." The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. When I was in seminary, one of my favorite professors, Professor Beth Leeper, used to say, "You can never make Jesus too human." When she first would say that, I wondered, what does she mean by that? But we all know Jesus was a man. We know he lived and walked this earth. What would be the danger? Why would somebody not make him human? But as the years have gone by, I've come to realize that although a lot of people accept that he was human, there's a lot of people who ignore that. I'm not talking about people who aren't part of the Christian church. I'm talking about people who are outside our walls. They're like, "Yeah, he was human. Probably wasn't much of God. We don't know." They're kind of indifferent to that, right? They say, it doesn't really matter. You know, you hear all these things about the historical Jesus, and they're focused just on the human side. But what about those within the church? Do we have a good balance of understanding Jesus as being both fully human and fully divine? See, I think we tend, as Professor Leeper was trying to allude, we have a tendency to think of God, to think of Jesus, more in the spiritual terms. We accept that he was a human being. We don't like to spend a lot of time there. We like to think about God as spirit. And so you hear people say, "Well, I don't have to come to church to believe. I can meet God anywhere." And yes, that's true. We can meet God anywhere. But the danger is when we make God so spiritual, we make Jesus so spiritual that he loses any earthly good. We tend to think of Jesus just in this symbolic way, not truly human. But in his humanity, Jesus was born, he lived, he suffered, and he died. He wept. He rejoiced. He ate with his friends in a community of fellowship. He grew tired. He got angry. And when he was beaten, bloodied, and bruised, he felt all of it. He felt the sting of every one of those lashes from the whip. He felt the ache of those bruises. He felt the weight of his cross as he walked and carried it to Calvary. He felt the sting of the sweat in his eyes. We don't like to think about Jesus that way. We'd much rather think of him as the gentle, loving Lord who heals and forgives everyone, restoring life to everyone who believes. But a Jesus who only did that and never truly felt and experienced the fullness that is life, that is human life, with all its joys and its sorrows and its pains, could never fully pay the price for our sin. Because it is in this identification of God as Emmanuel, God with us, as Jesus Christ, that the power to heal, the power to forgive, the power to restore wholeness to all people and save us resides. When we forget Jesus' humanity or we neglect it, we risk reducing Jesus to being what the Reverend Craig Kester calls an expression of spiritual or ethical ideals. His wholeness as both fully human and fully divine is robbed from who he is. Our first two readings today, especially the first one from 1 John, were written at a time when the church was experiencing division. It was splitting apart because people were arguing over the character of who Jesus was. Was he fully divine? Was he fully human? Which mattered more? And there was a whole group of folks who had left the church, had separated out, and developed a very highly spiritualized view of Christ. So the writer of 1 John is concerned that people are going to follow after this. And they're going to lose sight of the reality of the man, of Jesus, of God, who came down and walked and lived among us. So this letter begins with an emphasis on Jesus' fleshly being. The writer speaks of seeing and hearing and touching Jesus. This reality is crucial to faith. This truth is what 1 John testifies to, and it has been witnessed and is now proclaimed to all people. You see, for 1 John, to merely say, "I believe," is not enough. Faith must be lived out in our actions together, in community, in fellowship, in what the Greek term is koinonia. This koinonia is grounded in our faith and our real relationship with God, the Father, and Jesus Christ, the Son. Everything that the writer declares to the reader is intended to invite him or her into that fellowship. Because it is only in this fellowship that joy can be complete. In other words, only by living together with Christ and one another can we experience the full joy that God intends for us. Not everyone in our world believes this. As I said, we've heard people say, "I can find God anywhere. I don't need to come to church. I don't need to be a part of that community." The danger with that is because when we make Jesus into this spiritualized me and Jesus and nobody else thing, we tend to become very narcissistic. And it becomes all about us and what Jesus is doing for me. And we lose sight of what Jesus did for all. We are called as believers to live our faith in community. Jesus doesn't ask us to walk this path alone. He calls us to live out our beliefs in relationship with one another, even when that's difficult and we may disagree about some things. He invites us to be a part of fellowship with God the Father and other believers. Our faith is not just an ethical way of living, not just some sort of spiritual set of ideals. It's about life together. Let me share a story with you that I think will help. There was, many years ago, in Scotland, a man who decided he didn't need to come to church anymore. So he wouldn't come to church. He'd stay home on Sunday mornings. And of course, the other people in his congregation were concerned about him. They missed him. They needed him to be a part of who they were. So they went to the pastor and said, "Pastor, is there anything you can say to him? He won't listen to us." And the pastor said, "Well, I'll try. I'll go there and see what I can do." So the pastor goes to visit the man and knocks on the door. The man says to the pastor, "I know why you're here. You're not going to change my mind." Pastor says, "Well, you know, it's been a long walk. Can we just sit by the fire and maybe have a cup of tea together?" Man says, "Well, all right, Pastor. I could at least be nice. That would be the Christian thing to do." So as the man put together the tea and put it on the fire for warmth, The pastor sat next to them. They just sat in each other's presence. While they were sitting, the pastor took a stick and pulled one of the embers that was burning in the fire out onto the hearth and just let it sit there. And while the tea was brewing, the two men watched this ember. And gradually, the ember went from bright red and glowing and alive to black and cold and dead. The man looked at the pastor and said, "Aye, Pastor, I'll be back in church on Sunday." You see, brothers and sisters, we need each other to keep our faith growing and glowing, to keep us on fire for the Lord. The world tells us, be independent, stand on your own, do it by yourself. But God says, I've given you fellowship, I've given you a community to help you on this path. And not only that, there I am in the midst with you. So brothers and sisters, as you think about faith, as you think about those who aren't here, maybe they're traveling, maybe they're just tired, maybe they're feeling like they need to pull away, remember the community, reach out to them, continue to bring them in and remind them of the strength we get from one another.